This is how you could defeat Wolverine with science. There are many practically indestructible characters in pop culture, from The Incredible Hulk to Deadpool to Superman and to, of course, Wolverine. And Wolverine in particular is an interesting case because half the reason he is so hard to destroy is straight up science, the adamantium grafted onto his bones. Which means if you had to, science would also be the best way to defeat him. Found you. Let's set up a hypothetical scenario. Say we are some kind of, supervillain, and we want to defeat Wolverine. I don't know, maybe we fundamentally disagree with how veiny he is in all the movies. If we tracked or lured Wolverine to some location, I see four main advantages of his that we would have to contend with. First of all, he's very fast. He's very strong. He's very durable, and he's very sharp. Cool, thanks. Given everything that makes Wolverine so dangerous, if we wanted to defeat him, then keeping him at a distance would be our best bet, as would attacking him in ways that don't immediately fail to his healing factor. So now, it's time to set a trap. Ooh, supervillain chuckling. Still backing up. We can start simple. Oxygen is one of the most critical components in the trillions and trillions of continuous chemical reactions that you call whatever your name is. Unlike food, unlike water, the amount of time that you can survive without O2 is obviously measured in seconds and not weeks or days. You need oxygen to live, but you also need oxygen to heal. According to a recent study in the journal Wounds, oxygen must be tightly governed in all phases of wound healing to produce viable tissue. Nearly every step in the wound healing process requires oxygen. In other words, without O2, Logan wouldn't be able to live, nor would he be able to regenerate. And so to defeat Wolverine, one tactic would be to cut off the oxygen. Our first mutant fighting move is to construct a giant vacuum chamber. I call it Void Boy. Outfitted with half a dozen turbo pumps, all we would have to do is find some way to lure Wolverine inside Void Boy here. I don't know, maybe we tell him that there's a sick motorcycle in there? Yeah, he'd never be able to resist that. Once he's inside, we seal him in, and if we constructed this chamber correctly with the right dimensions and the right pumping requirements, within a few seconds, he would pass out due to lack of oxygen. Within a few minutes, he would die, and within a few hours, he would be under space-like conditions with no oxygen to breathe or regenerate with. A chamber like this wouldn't be impossible to construct either. NASA has one at their space power facility. It's giant, it's cold, it has thick concrete walls that Wolverine wouldn't be able to get through, and it can simulate a space-like environment to test NASA's equipment in just a few short hours of turbo pumping. Let's just check on Wolverine real quick. Or we could deprive Wolverine of oxygen and therefore the ability to regenerate with another fluid, water. If we lured him into a similarly constructed chamber with the promise of, I don't know, Canada's finest poutine, then once he was inside, we could turbo pump in water until there was no air left for Logan and he would sink to the bottom of the chamber because he's denser than the average person because of all the adamantium. Even if, in both of these chambers, Wolverine doesn't asphyxiate or drown and die in the same way that we would die, eventually all his cells in these situations would run out of oxygen and he would have to truly die, barring some comic book miracle. Oh, look, alternate universe, he's fine again. We can go on the offensive too, because even though we can't make it through Wolverine's adamantium, we can still affect what's inside. Even in theory, there is no theoretical sports helmet that could prevent 100% of concussions. Physics makes that impossible. Your brain is not pressed right up against your skull. It is floating in sweet, sweet thought juice. And so if you impact your skull with something, your skull will move, as will the helmet that you're wearing. But when everything comes to a stop, because it has some distance to travel through that sick thought fluid, your brain can keep going thanks to inertia and impact the side of your skull. And when that happens, you can get bleeding, bruising, and shearing of the brain, a concussion. The inevitability of your brain's inertia was summed up this way by a study published in 2012 in the journal Clinics in Sports Medicine. They say, quote, "At this point, there is little evidence supporting the use of specific helmets or mouthguards to prevent concussion. In other words, no matter what Wolverine's skull is made out of, adamantium or not, we can still concuss him." Good. Our second anti-Wolverine tactic will be to concuss him from afar, and by far the easiest way to do that would be to get some kind of projectile with enough impact force behind it that it will accelerate Wolverine's head, skull, and brain like a linebacker would. Good, he doesn't smell us yet, he's staying over there. Oh, fresh. To give Wolverine the benefit of the doubt here, let's be very conservative and start with just a basic 9mm bullet fired from a handgun. Let's say that it's traveling a little over the speed of sound when it impacts Wolverine's indestructible skull in a little over a millisecond and it has 8 grams of mass. Do the math and we get a little over 2,700 newtons of force. Using this force value, we can now apply it to Wolverine's head to see how much this force can accelerate it. Assuming that all this force goes perfectly into accelerating Wolverine's head, I assume that his head had a little bit more mass than the average person's head, then you find that this bullet, this simple bullet, could accelerate it at up to 63 Gs. 60 Gs is well within concussion range for a human. No, he must smell us, but I was so fresh! Wolverine has human-like physiology, which means that if our math is correct, we could incapacitate him. Fire! With relatively modest hardware and then dispose of him as we wish later. And it turns out that our math is correct. In 2015, the Institute of Security Technologies published a study that, In 2015, the Institute of Security Technologies published a study reporting on experiments that were done on cadaver skulls. They were firing 9mm bullets at these skulls wearing military-grade helmets, and they found, in the majority of cases, brain injury like concussion. That's because, like Wolverine's adamantium skull, the helmets were absorbing the impact but still dangerously accelerating the head. And other studies have found similar results. The fact that concussing Wolverine with a handgun or any larger firearm is a viable tactic, according to math, makes this scene in X2 technically the most accurate scene in any X-Men film? Of course, behind this one. What is even happening there? Is he spinning around and then coming back? Is he cutting through it as he's going? Is he? Our science-y strategy could be so much more than Homo sapiens and their guns, though, because Wolverine's worst enemy might be electromagnetism. If you're familiar at all with Wolverine, you know that his metal endoskeleton is extremely susceptible to magnetic fields. In one of the most famous X-Men panels of all time, Magneto uses this fact to rip all the adamantium out of his body at once. Yeesh. And if his endoskeleton responds to magnetism in this way, it means that it's probably a good conductor, which means that we can affect it with electromagnetism in a much more sinister and sciencey way. Oh! Wow! When you run an electric current through a material like a metal that is a conductor, if it's not a superconductor, it will start to build up resistance inside of it in the form of heat. If that heat gets high enough and you have the right material, you can start to emit light. That's how incandescent light bulbs work. Or you can use this resistance property to just put so much current through a material that you liquefy it. Now, I know what you're probably already thinking. If we want to defeat Wolverine in this way, why not just hook him up to a source of extreme voltage and burn him to death from the inside out? Well, that's a good idea, nerd. It's so good an idea that that's what the Punisher did to kill Wolverine already. But remember, we are just mere mortals, and we don't want to get anywhere near Wolverine and his claws like the Punisher did. Don't worry, though. There is another way. Back! Back! Back, I say! That option is called induction heating, and oh, it's so evil. Electricity and magnetism are linked, electromagnetism, and one very cool and almost magical property of this linkage is called induction. So, for example, if I took a magnet and its magnetic field and I moved it through this coil of wire, it would induce or create an electrical current inside of that wire, and this works the other way too. If we run a changing electrical current through this wire, it will create a changing magnetic field through this loop. Now, if we take some conductor and put it in this changing magnetic field, it will induce an electrical current inside of the conductor, which will induce heat, induction heating, and it will get really, really hot, and I think you can see where we're going with this. We construct a giant cylinder and wrap miles and miles of extra conductive wire around it where heroes go to die. I call it the Dangerously Conductive Electrical Unit, or DCEU. Then we lure Wolverine inside. I don't know, we tell him there's half a cigar in there. Yeah, yeah, that will do the trick. He could never resist that. Then once he's inside, we flick the switch, sending a dangerous amount of electrical current through these wires, which creates a giant changing magnetic field inside of it, which starts to induce an electrical current inside of Wolverine's adamantium, which creates heat, so much heat, in fact, through this induction heating process, that everything aside from his adamantium starts to boil off of his body until there is nothing left but metal scaffolding. Whew, Magneto. Wolverine has been defeated many, many times in various media, almost always at the hands of some super being. We may not be super, but with a little knowledge of his powers, how they work, how to circumvent them and take advantage of them with science, we could best the beast too, with vacuum, acceleration, and electromagnetism. Because science. Am I a bad guy now? This video could easily have been an hour long because Wolverine has died in the comics canonically over a dozen times. So there are many different ways to tackle this situation. I went with the most sciencey, coolest sounding to me ways, like induction heating. One of the coolest in the comics though that I've seen is in The Death of Wolverine, and spoilers if you haven't read it. But at the very end, Wolverine dies because he is encased in an adamantium sarcophagus. He pierces a tub of adamantium, which covers him and then solidifies, and he is stuck in it as like a statue of himself in adamantium, and he suffocates in there, which is a beautiful comic panel, and it also proves our point about oxygen. Think about that. Ow. Thank you so much for watching, James. If you want more of me, please follow us on social media at these handles. And the big thing I want to remind you of is the science of Mortal Kombat. It's out. The very first episode and the first behind the scenes episode are now on Because Science's YouTube channel. We put some Sub-Zero fatalities to the test. You're going to want to check it out.